And now it's my great pleasure and privilege on the Stephen Holt Show. Yes, we're still at the Toronto International Film Festival. We're just always there, you know, like Ed Grimley. But anyway, I think they based him on me. I don't know about that, but I this is, well, anyway, that's another program. Martin Short, he's brilliant. But anyway, we're here with another great programmer and director of the Toronto International Film Festival, one of the people who's made it what it is today. According to Piers Handling, who said that, we're here with Noah Cowan. It's very wonderful to meet you finally.
It's great to have this chance to meet you too, Stephen. And if you'd like to move to Toronto, we can arrange the paperwork. Let us know.
Oh, all right. Okay.
Even just a September visa. We can work on that.
Oh, okay. Okay. yes. You know, after, oh boy, I'm excited now, but I'm very excited about, first I have to tell you an anecdote about your parents.
Uh-oh.
I know.
They're the madcap ones.
Yes. No, it was delightful. I was in a line that was like very long and time consuming. The first day last year, I think it was for The Wind That Shakes the Barley. Mm-hmm. And who was standing in front of me? And eventually we were there so long they had to finally reveal how they got the tickets, but they were your parents. Your mother's an Irish actress.
Yes.
And your father is Canadian producer, TV.
Yeah, I've been very blessed to come from a really artistically minded family. So I got exposed to a lot of this madness very early on.
My mother, and your parents were delightful. They were really
proud
of you, and they were very behind every single move you made. You
I know. They're incredibly sweet, but I think they owe it to me, frankly. My mother trained me to have a very loud laugh when I was about 5 or 6 years old, and threw me in the back row whenever she had all the old ladies come to the theater, so that I would get them laughing. Because Ontarians aren't very good with, you know, laughing out loud.
Okay.
So I was there to prompt them from the ages of 7 to 11. So they better be nice to me now.
Well, they were thrilled to be going to see When the Shakes the Barley, and they didn't mind the line, and it was just a great moment. Because
they're wonderful.
And they told me your entire life story, which sort of involves Concordia.
No, McGill University in Montreal.
McGill University.
Absolutely.
I knew it involved Montreal somehow, but here you are today, and now you're, despite, in addition to being one of the artistic directors, you've been now made the king of the Bell Lightbox, I guess.
I'm getting all these new titles. It's actually great. I was called a guru a couple days ago, and now I'm a king.
The king of the king
prince.
Of Canada.
I love it. You know, I want every title in the book now.
Yes. And you'll get them, and your parents were so proud of all your accomplishments.
That's fantastic. No, it's actually been a very interesting and unusual change.
Normally,
in arts organizations, people leave, people come in, and things like that, but we have a very collegial approach. I mean, you've spoken to the big boss, the CEO of the festival group, Piers Handling.
Yes,
you see a relaxed guy.
Yes, he is.
Very collaborative, you know, likes to surround himself with people full of ideas.
And he's very inclusive.
Very.
And it's a committee. It's a group of people running this festival. He wanted to make that clear. It's not just him and you.
It's a big festival.
Oh, you know, my God. It's just, I've seen like as many movies as I possibly could see, and like I'm still like, you know, I still have missed like 400 movies or something.
You could do better.
I could do better.
Next year we want you to do more.
But this, I just love, I mean,
it's gonna be amazing.
I often stayed at the Holiday Inn on King, and the difference.
And how did that go?
Oh, it was delightful. Don't eat the food. But anyway, it's adjacent to the location of the Bell Lightbox, which I have filmed that. I filmed the parking lot. I filmed people looking at the parking lot. I filmed Marlon Kiernan, who's no longer the head of it, was like pointing at it and, you know, describing what was going to be in the parking lot. And I've been attended meetings, which we've aired on the development since,
well,
I don't
fantastic.
Know, 02, 03, something?
I mean, it's been, we've been working on this for a long time, but last Christmas.
And now we have pictures and it's like under construction. I mean, this construction
being
going
made
on
right now. No, we're forming concrete. You can actually see the outsides of some of the
That's
cinemas.
That's so exciting.
It's thing. It's really great.
It's so exciting.
No, it's a great thing. So last Christmas, we basically decided to expand the sort of senior leadership of the programming team, and the wonderful Cameron Bailey,
who we just spoke to earlier,
who's great, who's come
he's
in
wonderful.
And done a bang up job on this year's festival. He was the primary go-to guy for this year's TIFF.
Okay.
And so if there's any kudos for this one, they should be directed his way. They're amazing.
And it's
amazing films and a great lineup, and I thought really well scheduled. I thought people felt the festival rolled out really well this year. So he's amazing. I thought I was irreplaceable, but no.
Oh, well, but
turns out not.
Oh, but you've got this on your hands, and then
no.
For how now? What is the schedule with this, and what is it we're looking at? These are all
renderings.
Yeah,
so there
was something
people.
Special about this little box.
That's the special box inside the light box.
Is that like
special
controls
boxes.
Everything
yeah,
or
yeah,
something?
Yeah, that's the master control. We have approximately 70 different kinds of screens within the building. Everything from like tiniest little TV up to the granddaddy screen of them all in Cinema One. And they're all interconnected. So you can, anything that's happening anywhere in the building, it's all plug and play and all these other technical terms I don't quite understand. But anything in the building can talk to anything else. And so if you have a performance happening outside on the red carpet, or if you have some wonderful conversation with a director or a great educational program.
We have the red carpet in the background over there. Is that what that is?
Yeah, that'll take you right in the front doors, and you're going to go up these shiny escalators. That's the wall of Cinema 3, the outer wall of Cinema 3 that you can project onto, which is really great fun.
Oh, God.
As you can see, the concept, if you let me get heady for a second here, the concept of the building, which we thought was absurd when we first heard it, was this huge vaulted atrium that for a cinema palace, for this amazing Bell Lightbox. The architect, you're crazy. Cinema's in the dark. You know, you have to be in an enclosed room. But what he did is build these beautiful atriums, and then the cinemas hang like apples in a tree, sticking inside and outside of the building.
Wow.
So they even extrude out into the street, or they come back into the space so you can point to them. And you know why he said that?
Why?
Because film is the most accessible, the most populist of media, so people should know where they're going. People should know where the place is.
And who is the wonderful architect whose idea this was?
He's amazing. His name is Bruce Kuwabara. He's Canadian. He's one of the hottest new architects, though, in the world. Designed beautiful buildings in Berlin. He's actually doing a big project in New York right now. And some of the finest buildings in this city, including the Gardner Museum, are of his creation and design. So we were blessed to have him. And what an exciting and interesting concept. So I think people are going to
And how many cinemas
really
are going to be in here?
Five.
I hope they all would be in the same building, but no.
No. We're still, I don't think one building could contain this festival anymore.
No.
I mean, even we'd have to take over about half of Iowa. I think we're actually going to try to do that.
And
so.
There's the whole new AMC building that went up, and this whole thing in Yonge and Dundas, and now this. I mean, it's just so exciting. And when is it going to be finished? Do we have any idea?
We do. I mean, I think construction should be done. It's Canada, so that's complicated sometimes because there's this thing called winter, and that can sometimes delay things. But we think we'll be done probably the initial construction in early 2010. It's 50-50 whether we make it for fully into the festival in 2010. We're going to know probably that winter. We'd all love to be in because we want to show it off. But we're hedging our bets right now, because you never really know.
And what else is, I think there are other things besides the five theaters that are going to be in there.
Absolutely. I mean, the point of this building is that we're going to do everything in our power to inspire people's passions. This is something we've been talking about all festival.
Wonderful.
And when we talk about people's passions, you realize that film is unique as a teaching tool and as an inspirational tool. Nothing else in culture do people go to actually find out ideas about other things. So most people I know actually learned and wanted to know more about genocide because of seeing a film like Hotel Rwanda. You know, people went to see, people really got excited about the environment, decided they really wanted to get involved in environment because they saw an inconceivable truth, you know, the Al Gore film. So amazing, you know, that we have this power of cinema. So that's really what the Bell Lightbox is based on. The concept is actually to inspire people through films. So all of this transparency, all of these different areas for people to gather in bars and restaurants galleries. In art galleries and in educational spaces is so that we have multiple communities gathering and discussing what's inspired them on screen.